And this session and the next one would be on 3D equilibrium. In 2D equilibrium is already completed. So from there, what we have learned that for a rigid body to be in equilibrium, we need three equilibrium conditions, that were sum of force along x equals to 0, sum of force along y equals to 0, and moment about a point was equals to 0. Now, these are three conditions of equilibrium for a rigid body. Then if you have more rigid bodies, that means interconnected rigid bodies, then they will multiply. So, based on that, you can actually solve for the support reactions. So, for a single rigid body in 2D equilibrium, we discussed that we can solve three support reactions, and if it is so, then problem was statically determinate. Now, in case of 3D equilibrium, remember that we are now going to get six scalar equations that will be required for the equilibrium, and we can use these six equilibrium conditions, as you see here in scalar form, that is three force equations and three moment equations. They can be used to solve no more than six unknowns, and these six unknowns generally represent reactions at supports or connections. But remember, it is not mandatory that all the time I have to use three force equations and three moment equations. So, for example, you can actually augment one of the force equations by another moment equations. So, that is always possible. Now, the main idea that would be actually, if you think of it, how do I get these scalar solutions, you know, scalar rather equilibrium equations. So, we get that equilibrium equations based on the fact that I make the resultant force on the rigid body equals to 0, and the resultant moment at a particular point O, right, that is equals to 0. So, we have already discussed this. So, how to do R cross F? So, if you have various forces on the system, so we have to do this vector operations. So, ultimately, as you see, that moment about a point, okay. So, moment about any point O, if you consider that equals to 0, then you are going to get three scalar equations, and that are actually placed here. So, therefore, now what is important is that to understand that instead of doing this operation right here, that is R cross F, we can also do directly moment about an axis. Instead of moment about a point, I can also do moment about an axis by using lambda dot R cross F. And we have done that in the very beginning, that lambda dot R cross F, that is the moment of a force about an axis, and if you add the effect of all the forces, that is also going to give you a equation, and that equation we can use to also get the support reactions as possible. Okay. So, in 3D equilibrium, as I said, that it will be more relevant in most of the problems, as we will see, that attempt to use moment about an axis. That can be done, as you know, that force times the perpendicular distance, that way. Or if it is more complex, you know, system, then you can also do lambda dot R cross F. So, ultimately, as we have seen here, that for a given rigid body, I can solve six unknowns. Now, if you have more than six unknowns for a given rigid body, then I won't be able to solve for all the unknowns. It is not possible. But again, remember, therefore, what is happening is that if the problem remains statically indeterminate, that is, my number of unknowns are exceeding the number of equilibrium equations, which are 6 in this case. Therefore, I may not be able to solve for all the unknowns, but in problems, in applications, you will see that few unknowns can still be solved. So, we just have to keep this in mind. Now, therefore, what remains for us to understand that how do we visualize the support reactions as well as the connections. Okay. So, that would be the basis of the discussion for a while now. So, likewise, as we have done in 2D equilibrium, as you have learnt that for a roller support, I have one reaction, that is vertical. For a pin support, I have two reactions, that is horizontal and vertical. That means, again, you have one force unknown along with the its line of action is also unknown. So, for a pin support, you have actually two unknowns at support reactions, and for a fixed support, I had three unknowns at support reactions, that is horizontal reaction, vertical reaction, as well as a moment reactions. Now, how did you get to that? Remember, the main idea was to understand that whenever I do not allow a movement, I am going to get a reaction back. That means, how many movements are possible in a 3D body? As we know that I have 3 translational motion and 3 rotational motion. So, therefore, now as we understand that, therefore, whenever one of these motion is prevented, that means body is unable to do that motion, I am bound to get a reaction back. So, if you just go by words, this basic logic, we will try to see what are the reactions that are going to come into the free body diagram when I isolate the body from the supports. So, here now you have basically we have a rigid body here, and that is placed on a ball. So, what is happening now? The body is unable to make a movement downward. So, we are going to get a reaction, that reaction is now vertical, and we also know the line of action. Therefore, my unknown is just one. So, I have just one unknown here, that is the support reaction. So, this will happen on a frictionless surface, or if a body is resting on a ball, let us say. Similarly, let us say I have a rigid body which is connected by a cable. So, therefore, as we can see clearly, that cable will induce a reaction back to the body, and that line of action is known. Only thing that we know again, the unknown is here really the magnitude of that reaction. Similarly, if you go to the more complex supports, for example, let us look at this. The rigid body is connected to a wheel, and that wheel is on a rail. Okay. So, now what happens in this case? We have to look at the 3 translational motion and the 3 rotational motion, and we have to identify that what are the motions are not possible. If the motions are not possible, then I am going to get support reaction. Therefore, what is happening as you see here that basically, the rigid body cannot move downward. Therefore, I have a reaction that is upward. So, Fy is one reaction. Similarly, since it is on a wheel, that rail is there. Therefore, wheel is unable to move also horizontally this way, and therefore, I am going to get a reaction. Remember, the other motion this rigid body can do, all other motion. For example, it can rotate about y axis. Similarly, if you consider this is x axis, which is along the rail, it can rotate very slightly about that axis as well. Similarly, since there is a gap possible, it can also rotate a little bit about a y axis. Therefore, I am not going to get moment as reactions in this case, as well as remember there is no reaction coming from the x axis as well, because wheel can move, therefore body is able to move in this direction. Next would be the ball and socket joint. Now, in a ball and socket joint, that is very much used, as you can see, very perfect example would be basically our, you know, femur system. If you look at the bones, okay, our hip joint, for example. Now, as you can see here, that one, you know, this socket is actually, you know, two bones are connected by the ball and socket. So, it can actually rotate about any axis, but what it can't do, it cannot actually allow the translational motion. Therefore, what is happening, the translational motion is prevented in the three directions, and if it is so, therefore, we are going to get again support reactions in the three directions, translational directions. So, therefore, we have three support reactions as unknowns. So, if we go to more complicated system, I will just talk about the fixed support first, because in 2D you also have a fixed support, and for 2D we have already seen that for a 2D body, x, y and z, if you choose, then along the x the body cannot move, right, along the y it cannot move, and it cannot rotate about the y axis, let us say. Therefore, you have moment it cannot rotate about the z axis, I am sorry. So, therefore, you have moment about the z axis. So, you have basically f x, f y and m z was the three support reactions. So, in the fixed case, in the 3D equilibrium case, now you can think of what is happening. Basically, motion is prevented in all, you know, possible motions are prevented. So, all translational motion as well as rotational motions are prevented. Therefore, I have six reactions. I have three translational reactions and I have three moment as reactions. Okay, so, three force reactions and three moment reactions. So, now if you look at some other joints that are very much used, this is called a universal joint. Let us look at the mechanism. What we have is basically, see, you have basically, you know, kind of a cross section here. So, you see here that these two are perfectly welded. Here you see that these are two perfectly welded at the joint, okay. But this pin right here, this member right here is connected by a pin to the rigid body. So, these two ends here, they have screws, you can think of they have just screws, okay. Similarly, these two ends of this member has screws here, okay. So, what will happen eventually, therefore, if you look at the x and y, this body, the body can rotate about this axis, okay. So, if you look at this, it will be able to rotate about this axis, this body and that body as well. So, if they are rotating about this axis, then there will be no moment. So, this axis is actually z axis. So, there is no moment about this axis. So, there is no reaction. Similarly, these two bodies can also rotate about this axis right here, which is our y axis, okay. So, if it can able to rotate about the y axis, then again I do not have a moment as a reaction. But what these bodies can't do, they can't rotate about their own axis. Own axis means that is x axis, okay. So, if they can't do that, therefore, I have moment as a reaction. So, again I will repeat that this is a interconnected mechanism, and these two small members, so this joint basically has two small members perfectly welded, and they are basically screwed at their ends with the connected bodies. That is the basic concept, and therefore, what is happening, now you can see none of the rigid bodies will make any translational motion. So translational motion will be prevented in all directions. Therefore, we are going to have three reactions, force reactions, but they will be able to rotate about the y axis, they will be able to rotate about y axis. So I don't have moment as a reactions. However, these two bodies cannot rotate about their own axis. So therefore, I am going to get a moment reaction. Clear? So next, look at some of the problems, you know, involving bearings. Now, bearings are typically used in lot of mechanical problems, as you have seen journal bearings, thrust bearings, and so on so forth. What happens in that case? So remember, this is a bearing. So actual photograph is given, that's your bearing, and an axial shaft will go into this bearing. So we have this axial shaft. So our intention would be to understand what is the free body of this axle or shaft that is on the bearing when I isolate this from the bearing. Therefore, I have to understand that what are the support reactions coming from the bearing to the body. That body is the shaft or the axle. Now look at carefully what can happen. What is being said here is that hinge and bearing supporting radial load only. So that means the type of load that I am going to see is only the moment about its own axis. Okay, so it is carrying the radial load. So whatever load I apply, they are radial in nature. So in that way, remember what will happen in the process. Okay, you may have a vertical load, you may attach one perpendicular bar, put some loading here and here. So in the process, what is happening, as we can see, what the body cannot do, basically it is not allowed to, you know, move up like this, it is not allowed to move out of the bearing like that, right. So y and z motion is prevented, translational. Therefore, I have two support reactions here. Okay, the body can, however, since it is not carrying any axial load, that means I don't need the axial, you know, reaction as well. So that axial reaction is also missing. Remember, what it can do, it is actually can rotate about its own axis. That's the whole idea. So if it can rotate about its own axis, that means that rotation is allowed. Therefore, I should not have the moment as a reaction. So what I don't have basically in this problem, mostly I don't have the moment about as a reaction about its own axis of this body, of this shaft or of this axle. We have all other things present. That means I have moment about this axis, I have moment about this axis, as well as reactions are present. Okay. Only thing I don't have a axial reaction, the reason being it is not taking any axial load also. So I am not putting any load like this, or maybe any inclined load on this body, which is my shaft or a axle. Okay. Now just take this and try to just understand what happens if I now apply an inclined load, or maybe just if I apply an axial load, then in order to prevent the motion in the axial direction, all I have to do, I have to somehow manage to block the motion, you know, in the axial direction. Therefore, thrust bearings are used. So in the thrust bearing, you will also see that I will have a reaction along the axial direction. So this is a force reaction along the axial direction. Very common example we see day to day life is the hinge on a door or on a window. We see this, right? On a door, I can only rotate the door about this hinge axis. The door is unable to make any other motion about any other axis. So only thing that is allowed to do is rotate about its own axis, which is the x axis in this case. Therefore, as we see that I have no moment as a reaction. So typically speaking, when the problem comes, most often we are going to see this and this one. These will be typical problems, as well as this one, fixed support. And if I go back a little bit, we are also going to see lot of ball and socket joint. as well as this is very common. Okay. So ultimately problem will involve when we discuss to the, you know, come to the discussions of different problems, we are going to see more often this one, ball and socket joint, or maybe a roller and so on. Okay. So before I proceed to, you know, different problems, now you can only understand this by, you know, taking many problems and try to see how we can, you know, do the simplification. So basically, as I said, the reaction is one part that we first understand. Then what we really have to do, we have to think that how to get these unknowns. To solve for the unknowns, we will always try to attempt to do the moment about an axis. We will try to avoid as much as we can doing the R cross F, that means moment about a point O, and create three equations out of that. Typically speaking, if we keep doing the moment about an axis, we will be able to solve some unknowns very, very easily. And remember, moment about an axis can be solved by force times perpendicular distance from that axis. Okay? So we can keep maybe, let us say, 5 minutes just for the sake of discussions. If there is any, you know, doubts regarding the support reactions that we have discussed so far.
Sir, why there is no moment in x direction?
About which one? Which one? Which reaction are you talking about?
Sir, last one. Last one, the door. The example of a door that is hinge and bearing support.
Yes.
External thrust and radial load.
Okay. So think of the, so the question is, in case of a door, okay, the hinge, okay, look at the you know, hinge properly. So there we can clearly see that what, see, to understand the support reaction, important thing to understand that what are the degrees of freedom is actually doing the motion, right? I have 6 degrees of freedom, 3 translational and 3 rotational. Now, can you see clearly that which degrees of freedom is actually doing the, you know, some motion is there? The only motion that is allowed, that is about the x axis, that is the rotation about the own axis of the hinge, because when you pull the door, right, you are able to make the movement only about its own axis, right? So I have a rotational motion that is about its own axis. Therefore, we are not going to have any support reaction there. We are not going to get any moment reaction there. So wherever, whenever I have a motion allowed, I should not have a support reaction. If the support is allowing the motion, then I should not have a support reaction. Is that clear? Okay. I have another question popped up. Again, I will just explain the wheel on a rail. So there was a question on wheel on a rail, just go back there. So wheel on a rail, you see here clearly, see what it can do. Now when you place the wheel on this rail, okay, you can think of this wheel can little bit tilt about the x axis. Why there is no movement as a reaction? Because wheel can little bit tilt about x axis, or on the same logic, it can tilt about any other axis as well. That means x axis, y axis, as well as z axis. So it can little bit of rotate, so that rotation, the little movement is allowed. So it is therefore not taking any moment as reactions. Okay. So only thing that it cannot do, it cannot slide from the rail. The wheel cannot slide from the rail. And therefore, I have a force as a reaction, okay, that will prevent the, you know, sliding of the rail from the wheel from the rail, as well as we cannot do any vertical movement because it has to be properly grounded on the rail. So therefore, I am going to get this support reaction. It can of course make a translational motion along the x axis, right? Therefore, I don't have any reaction over there. Okay, clear now? So now what I will do, you know, I will just try to go to the problem. So I am going to take different problems and try to look at in a very simplified way that how we solve these problems. Okay. So the problem involves here is that of a window. and we can see here that window is hinged at A and B. Okay. So that means the only motion that it can do, if I attempt to, you know, if I have to really look at what are the support reactions here, you can clearly see that if I choose my z axis right here, if this is my z axis, let's say, so the, you know, movement is allowed, that means rotation is allowed about the z axis, right? Because if I try to close the window or if I try to open the window, it should rotate about the z axis. See, therefore, what I don't have, I just don't have the moment reaction about the z axis. Okay, I don't have moment reaction about the z axis. So this is a hinge problem again, just keep in mind. Now what is being asked here, that there was a cranking type opening mechanism that somehow failed. Now what we have done, we have basically provided a wooden prop. So CD is a wooden prop, right? So to hold the, you know, this one in position in certain configuration, I just put a prop, that prop is CD. Remember, the window itself has a weight, right? That weight is given, so it has its own mass center which is at the middle, and that weight is given by 50 kg or 500 newton. Okay? Now we are supposed to find out the compressive force CD. Again, why it should be compressive? Just get a physical feeling that, you know, it is trying to push this, you know, prop due to its weight. Okay, so therefore this is going to be compressive on the prop CD or the wooden bar CD. Now what I have to find out? I have to find out for this compressive force. So what would be the solution to this problem? How do I attack this problem? If I look at it carefully, I have hinge here, I have hinge here, 3D, you know, problem. So total reactions, as you see here at A and B, how many reactions are there? Total for each one of these, as we said, there will be 5 reactions. So 5, 10 reactions are there. Okay, that means 10 unknowns, plus I have one more unknown coming here, that is 11 unknowns are there. Now I won't be able to solve for all of these unknowns, because if I isolate this rigid body, that is my window, if I really isolate this, then I am going to get only 6 equilibrium equations. Now the problem demands that I have to only solve for CD, so I am not interested in finding out all other reactions also. So therefore the problem remains statically indeterminate. However, I can still solve for this force. The question is how I am going to solve for this force. Remember, if I take the moment about the AB axis, since there is no moment reaction about AB, right, and all other reactions are passing through, you know, will not come into play to the, when I am going to take the moment of this force and the weight about the AB axis, no other reactions are going to occupy the equilibrium equation. No other, you know, reactions are actually going to come into the equilibrium equations. The only forces that I am going to see in the equilibrium equations would be the FCD, right, and as well as the weight. So these are the two forces, FCD as well as the weight, they are going to contribute to the moment equation. So that's quite interesting. So what now, if you really try to do this problem, let's say R cross F you choose at about point A, let's say you take moment about point A, it's not going to go anywhere. Because if you take moment about point A, then other forces from the other reactions are going to, you know, come to your moment equation, because you have to do R cross F everywhere. So the point here is that instead of doing R cross F, I am really going to lambda dot R cross F. Now even that lambda dot R cross F operation, I may not need to do if I try to find out what is the perpendicular distance of different forces from the line AB. So, if I am taking moment about AB, all I would be interested to find out, hey, what is the perpendicular distance of this weight from, let us say, this line AB. Now, perpendicular distance means how I am going to do. So, really I have to look at this plane. So, from plane I have also a force here, what is that distance? Okay, remember this weight will have infinite line of action, right? And therefore, I just have to get the shortest path, okay, what is possible, shortest distance between the line of action of the load and the line AB, okay. So, now there is another trick here. The trick is, as I said just now, I said that a force will have an infinite line of action, okay. Now, when I isolate this body, let us try to do the free body diagram. I isolate this body. So, if we look at the free body diagram by isolating the body, remember I have 5 reactions here, it is shown here, 5 reactions here, okay. So, here Ax, Ay, Az, moment about x and moment about y. I do not have moment about z, that is the most important thing. Once I isolate this body and I look at FCD, now what I can do here, this FCD, instead of decomposing FCD at D, I can decompose FCD also at C. So, therefore, you can clearly see now FCD will have component in this case, right, in all directions. So, what is going to happen? You are going to say FCD x, FCD y, FCD z. So, therefore, when you take moment about line AB, your both FCD x, that means force along the x direction as well as force along the y direction, both are going to contribute to the moment. So, if you bypass that, and how do I bypass that? If I resolve it at C, because force at line infinite line of action. If I resolve it at C, then you see if I decompose here, only the x component of the force CD is going to contribute to the moment about AB. The other force, that means the y component, is already passing through AB, so that will not contribute to the moment. Now, only nitty-gritty about the 3D equilibrium is that you have no choice, you have to find out the position vector, you have to decompose the force into several components. So, those we have already studied in the vector mechanics, okay, when we discussed in the first session. So, therefore, as we can see, you do have to find out, okay, what is my FCD, right, that is a vector. So, that will have, you know, we have to find those, and to do that I have to first find out what is the unit vector along CD, right. Once I know the unit vector along CD, right, I just multiply that by the magnitude of the force FCD to get the force as a vector. And if you clearly see here that what will happen, that force CD again will have three components. Remember, it is going to have three components. These three components are given here. So, this is along x, this is along y, this is along z. Now, I am not really going to talk about here numbers, how you are getting those numbers. Those can be given to the students, you know, as an just to solve by themselves. So, here we are only going to be talking about the concept. So, as such we have found the FCD. Now, only thing that I said is that, now look at carefully, if I resolve the FCD right at point D, then what are the components will participate in the moment about AB? I have FCDX multiplied by the perpendicular distance, that perpendicular distance will be 0.8 cosine 50 degree, right? That is the moment about line AB, is not that? And for the FCD y, if you just, you know, look at the infinite line of action, what is the contribution? FCD y multiplied by 0.8 sin 50. So, if I decompose here, two, you know, part are going to contribute to the moment. So, if you try to avoid that calculation, I can decompose right here. I can still choose f c d x. So ultimate solution would be I have f c d x multiplied by 0.8. See, in this case it was f c d x multiplied by 0.8 cosine 50. But when you decompose at c, then I have only f c d x multiplied by 0.8. So y component of the force is passing through AB, line AB, therefore it will not contribute to the moment. What else do I have? I have also weight, the weight of the body, which is 50 kg. Okay? So how does weight contributes to the moment about line AB? It is simply going to be, as we can see from the distances, that 0.4, right, get the perpendicular distance, so that will be, we have to figure it out, so that is 0.4 sine of 50 degree. Okay? So this is the moment of the weight about the AB. So therefore, what I am basically doing, I am neither taking help of r cross f, neither I am doing a operation lambda dot r cross f. All I am saying that there are problems where you can simply get the moment by considering force multiplied by the perpendicular distance from the line. Okay? So if we look at now the solution, so ultimately I have explained all of this, but just spend a few minutes here. So what I basically said, that we take the moment of the forces, okay, about the line AB, okay, that line is passing through the z. Okay, so we have chosen the z axis here, does not matter. Okay, so we are taking the moment about this line, and as we can see here clearly, so the first part is the weight. So we have the weight here, I have taken 50 multiplied by 10, let's say 9.81. So 50 multiplied by, that is the force here, right? And we have said already what is the perpendicular distance. It is simply going to be 0.4 sin 50. Okay. Now if I choose this one will be negative. If I assume that counterclockwise moment is positive, anticlockwise moment is positive, then we can simply say this is negative. Then the other one, if you think of it, right, then this one is going to give f c d x multiplied by 0.8. So this is f c d x, this component right here, 0.828 f c d is f c d x, x component of f c d multiplied by 0.8, that is equals to 0. So I get the solution very, very easily. So neither I have taken help from r cross f, neither lambda dot r cross f. We have also made use of a very, you know, special thing that we tend to do, that force has an infinite line of action and I can decompose it anywhere when I take the moment, and I have taken the moment by decomposing the force at C, not at D. So this we have to keep in mind when we try to solve, you know, 3D problems. So only thing is that, yes, we agree that we do have to get the, you know, position vectors, we do have to get the force vector, that thing cannot be avoided, and those are coming mostly based on the geometry of the problem. Clear? So we'll move to the next problem as we see in day-to-day life. So the next problem is that of a rectangular signboard. Okay? So you see this signboard very often. Now just understand that how this signboard is supported. What are the different supports I have? We can clearly see it is connected by two cables on the wall. So there is a cable that will give reactions, force reaction, right? So I will have tension in the cables. Okay. What is also said, that the support against the wall at point C, that's a ball and socket joint. So at point C I have ball and socket joint, and at point D right here only support is provided along the y direction. That means motion is not allowed along the y direction, so therefore there is a reaction along the y direction. So how many unknowns do I have in this problem? I have exactly 6 unknowns, because this is my one unknown, second unknown, 3 unknowns here, because ball and socket joint, how many unknowns I have? three translational reaction, force reactions, right? So Cx, Cy and Cz, and here I have another unknown, that unknown is simply dy, okay. So total six unknowns are there, and I have one single rigid body, that means I have six equilibrium equations, and therefore I should be able to solve it. All the reactions can be solved, so it's a statically determinate problem. Now here is the main point. As I said, now if you want to make the thing more of a vector mechanics approach, you can simply take moment about any point you can take up all of these forces. That means you do r cross f for all the forces, equate it to 0, right? Therefore you are going to get a vector equation which will have three I, j, k, so you can have three scalar equations out of that. That is the moment, right? Similarly you could simply do sum of force along x 0, y 0 and z 0, you again have three equations. Now I am not going to do either of this, the reason being I want to visually inspect it and try to see if I can find out unknowns one at a time. How do I find out unknowns one at a time? See, observe one thing. Let's say I talk about x axis. I can clearly see there are so many reactions passing through x axis, so many forces. T1, T2 both pass through x axis. Similarly, y pass through x axis, right? That force right here will pass through the x axis. So what can happen? Similarly, you see that Cz, right, and Cx is parallel to x axis and Cy is also passing through x axis. So therefore, Cz and Cx will not participate in the moment about x axis. So only thing will happen is that you have Cy, right. If you take the moment about x axis, we will be surprised that we are only going to get Cy multiplied by 1 equals to 0, okay. So that means what I am saying here, that if you do a little bit calculations in this case, if you start looking at that, first of all I am not going through this process because I said that we are can bypass these operations. You have to find out what is T1 and what is T2. Right, that will come from the geometry of the problem. So T1 is the force vector we have found in terms of magnitude of T1, T2 force vector we have found in terms of magnitude of T2. So these studies we have to anyway do. Only thing, look at the moment equations. How I am doing it? Basically taking the moment about x axis. As I said, T1, T2 pass through x axis. You have this R, right, that's the only reaction here, and now C will have three components, remember Cx, Cy and Cz, but Cx is parallel to x axis, therefore it cannot contribute moment about x axis. Cz is passing through x axis, it will not contribute either. So therefore what will happen, that only Cy will contribute, and if I say Cy multiplied by 1, that should be equals to simply 0, right, because weight is also passing through x axis. So Cy becomes 0. So one unknown is already solved by doing just visually inspect the problem. What else I could do? Think of it, I can solve for Cy is already solved, right. Now Cx, let's look at, can I solve it by taking moment about one axis? We have to interrogate. We have to introspect that, can I find any of the reaction by taking moment about any axis? If I just choose Cx, right, and attempt to take the moment about AB, so what is happening in this case? Moment of AB will only be contributed by Cx and the W. W will give a moment, you can see W multiplied by 2, okay, that's the perpendicular distance, right? You have this plane here and you can see the perpendicular distance. If you project this infinite line of action, the perpendicular distance is this, right? So we have W multiplied by 2, that should be equals to C x multiplied by 3.5. All other forces will not participate in the moment about AB axis. Is that clear? So therefore, I can easily solve for Cx. So now Cy and Cx is solved. Okay, at least I was able to solve for two unknowns by taking moment about different axes. Let's move on to the what else I can do. Can you tell me quickly? I can get a very nice relation about T1 and T2. How do I get a relationship between T1 and T2? I can simply take moment about the z axis. Remember, no other forces will contribute to the moment about z axis except for T1 and T2. So therefore, if I do that, see first what I have done, take the moment about the z axis, right? So what are the components are participating of T1 and T2? Basically, we can see the x component will pass through the z axis. So that cannot participate. So only component that will participate, as we all see here, that the component of T2 along the y axis, right? That will participate in the moment about z axis. Similarly, the component of T1 about the, you know, y axis, along the y axis. So these are the two forces, that is the y component of T1 and y component of T2, that are going to participate when I take the moment about z axis. So we have clearly identified that, okay? And what we can see that we are going to get a relationship, all right? That relationship will come out nicely. So here there is a 0, so just make a note of this, this is 0 right here, okay? So we have taken the moment of the y component of the T2 and T1 about the z axis. So I get a relationship with the T1 and T2. Now what else I could do? I could, now remember Cx is already solved, right? I have solved Cx from the previous slide. Cx was how much? 0.561. Cy was 0. Now, if I do force along x direction, what are the components going to come in the force along x direction? Basically, the x component of T1, x component of T2 and Cx. So, the force along x, if I equate to 0, then I am again going to get a relationship between T1 and T2. Therefore, what happens in the process? I have now two equations to solve for T1 and T2. So that is how it is solved, okay? So far, we have more or less solved all of it, except for I think R is not solved. So we will try to solve that as well. So if I just take now sum of force along y direction equals to 0, I have to now do that because R is along the y axis, right? So if I solve the force along y axis, since all other unknowns are already solved, then I should be get the value of R. So therefore, R is now solved. Remember, in the process, I have actually consumed 6 equilibrium equations also. If you look at it carefully, I actually indeed used 6 equilibrium equations, but they are absolutely in different way. I have used 2 force equations, sum of force along x equals to 0, sum of force along y equals to 0. I have also used 4 moment equations, as we can see. This is one moment equation, this is a one, this is another one, right? Okay. So the point is that I have used 6 equilibrium equations indeed to get the all unknown forces that are, all unknown reactions that are possible, okay? Now we are going to move to the next problem. Just take the problems quickly. Now we have got the idea that taking the moment about various axes can actually resolve for different type, you know, different unknowns. Okay. So now let's talk about more complex problem. Let's say I have multiple rigid bodies connected. Okay. So in this problem, it is almost like a scissor. If you think of scissor. Okay, so now there you have a hinge here. So the bar AB and bar OD, they are connected by a pin at C. So therefore, now you think of it that I have one cable also being supported. There are ball and socket joints here. I apply a load P here. So a load is being applied right here. Now I have to find out what are the components of reactions at O and A, as well as I am interested in finding out what is the tension in this cable. Okay. So now if you look at this problem carefully, I have two rigid bodies. If I look at the externally, what are the support reactions? Ball and socket joints has three support reactions. So I have three support reaction here, three support reactions here, total six. What are the other unknowns? I have tension in the cable as unknown, right? Then you see, if I take a global equilibrium, there are seven unknowns. I can't solve it. Therefore, what needs to be done in this problem, if we think of it carefully, I need to detach. I have to detach OD and AB. And if I try to do that, then I will simply expose the reactions at this connection. How many reactions are present in these connections? There will be five reactions. Why it is so? Because what these bodies, two bodies can do, they can only rotate about an axis which is parallel to y axis passing through C. That means we call it CY. So CY axis, it can only rotate about this point. It is possible, the rotation is possible. Therefore, I don't have any moment reaction. But I have all other reactions. So I do have total of five reactions here. So therefore, I have three reactions here, three reactions here, six plus five, 11 plus one, 12 reactions. So 12 unknowns, sorry. So we have 12 unknowns in this problem. Now look at it. The total number of unknowns are 12. How many rigid bodies I have? I have two rigid bodies. Therefore, I should have total number of equilibrium equations should be 12. Problem is perfectly statically determinant. Therefore, I should be able to solve for all reactions are all unknowns. That means I should be able to solve for the ball and socket reaction here, here, cable reaction, as well as all the reactions here. But in the question, it is just asked to calculate the reaction at A, reaction at O, and the cable force. Okay. So now we think how I am going to start solving it. So first, let us try to look at the free body diagram. So that's a free body diagram, and remember I am always going to get the answer in terms of the known force P. Okay. Now this is a global equilibrium where I have not detached any bodies. So I have just looked at the free body of the entire system. If I look at the free body of the entire system, I have three reactions here, three reactions here, and one tension here. Now I won't be able to, as I said, I won't be able to solve for all the unknowns, all seven unknowns, but if I try to, you know, use the equilibrium equations in terms of by taking the moment about some axis, then I should be able to solve for some of the unknowns. So slowly, what we are going to see that, let's say I start with it, the way to write it, that sum of moment of all the forces about an axis x which is passing through O. So, O x is an axis. This is an axis which is passing through O and it is parallel to x axis. Now, in this case O itself is an origin, but we will always prefer to write like this O x. That means it is indicating an axis which is parallel to the x axis passing through O. Okay? Now, if I do that, what happens? If I take the moment about this axis, I can clearly see I will be immediately able to solve for Ay. So, what is happening? Ay multiplied by the distance, that is A, times equals to P multiplied by A. So, you can clearly see Ay is instantly solved. Similarly, how I do the other? Let us take moment about another axis which is the z axis, right. So, I write O z, that is z axis passing through O. If it is so, then what I am going to solve for? You see these two are passing through already z axis, these do not contribute, none of these contribute, right. None of these will contribute, only contribution that comes from P. And which component of T will contribute? The y component, because x component of T will pass through that z axis. Okay. So, therefore, what I have done here, the T by root 2, that is the component, okay, along the y axis, multiplied by A, as you see that is the moment about z axis, equals to P times A. So, this is solved. Similarly, we keep going like this. Just keep using sum of force along y equals to 0. Let us do that. Now, already I have solved for Ay, right. So, therefore, I should be able to solve for Oy. So, through this process, if I do sum of forces along the y axis equals to 0, since Ay is already known, right, and I know P and T is going to contribute. So, here I am simply trying to solve for Oy. So, Oy is suddenly solved. Okay. What else I can do? I keep going like this. How about moment about y axis also? I have already taken x and z. So, why not trying the moment about y axis also? If I do that, then you can clearly see that Ax equals to 0. Okay. So, x will be 0 if I do the moment about y axis, which is passing through O. Okay. So, similarly, if I now do, once Ax is known, let us say I do sum of force along x equals to 0, what would be the outcome? The outcome would be, since Ax is already solved, I will simply be able to solve for Ox. So, Ox is also solved. Now, I can still use one more equilibrium equation and you can try anything, but ultimately you will see that you are not going to solve for any other forces. So, what I have to do now? Now, I am going to detach the body. See, in the previous thing, what will happen if you attempt to take any other moment equation or force equation? You can use 6, but if you try to do that, you will get some relationship, but nothing can be solved. Okay. So, now what I am trying to say, now you have no other choice, but let us try to detach one of the bodies. So, once I detach one of the body, I can clearly see that what are the different reactions in this case coming into play. I have Ox, Y and Oz, Cx, Cy and Cz. But remember, there is a moment missing in this case. There is no moment about this axis which is parallel to y axis. So, Cy does not have any moment reaction, but we have moment reaction about the Cx and Cz. So, that is just a missing part. Please do a correction here. Then you can clearly see what I will try to do, since there is no moment reaction about this axis, right? I do not have any moment reaction. I will simply take the moment about this axis. So, what will happen if I take the moment about this axis? Okay, if I try to take the moment about this axis, I am simply going to get a relationship between Ox and Oz. Okay, because Ox multiplied by, you have to find that perpendicular distance, right? So, Ox, you know, we take the component of Ox, so that we make a parallel to the z axis, right? Okay, so Oz is there. So, in other words, if you do the moment, so you get Ox equals to Oz basically. And remember, Ox was already solved. Ox was already solved. Since Ox was solved, so I can easily get Oz equals to P. Okay? So, therefore, we are able to solve for all of the unknowns so far, except for there was another problem there. See, we still did not know, I think one of the unknowns was missing, that was Az I was unable to solve. See, from the previous study, Az I was unable to solve. Okay. So, Az was not solvable. So, now here we can also try to see if I can get the Az by some other means. So, the idea is set sum of force along x equals to 0, right? That is from the this case. So, what we are going to get actually, that now in this free body, Az is going to be, if I do this, now there has to be a relations from the previous slide. So, just need the Oz. So, from the previous slide actually, if we solve for Oz and Ox is solved. So, if I go back here, right here, okay, I can get Az and Oz. You see Az plus Oz is equals to 0. Right. So, from here Az and Oz equals to 0. So, that equation should have come in this slide itself. So, Az plus Oz equals to 0. Okay. And therefore, what we have already solved here, Oz is already solved. So, therefore, I can solve for Az. Clear? So, this equation should have gone in the previous slide by saying Az plus Oz equals to 0. Okay. So, Az plus Oz equals to 0. Now, only thing I solved in the previous step is the Oz equals to P. Therefore, Az equals to negative P. Okay. So, now more or less I have solved for all of the forces, whatever in question, now all of these are actually solved. Okay. So, this is the final solution.